All talks from the Awakening Soul series are available at soulcounseling.com.
Mad magic, mystic masters. Mad magic, mystic masters. Magic masters. Mad magic. Magic masters, mad magic. Magic mad. Master mystics. It's wordplay, but it represents real magic. Many real masters. I was just reading about a man who woke up through Siddha Yoga and the masters that assisted him. Many awakened masters appear mad, crazy. To the world. Another famous teacher in this century had masters that assisted him as a young boy, and to the rest of the world, they were crazy people, crazy wandering beggars, sadhus. We don't have quite the same box or history in the West as we do in India or in remote China of mad magic mystic masters. There's some of that, the Native American here and in South America, that when people were mad or crazy, they were touched by God. And we still have a little remnant saying of that, he's a little touched in the head. The finger of God reaches down and touches the mad, magic, crazy master in the head. He's a little touched. But we've almost effectively completely eradicated this as a viable, honored, allowable path in the West. It's too scary. Because it really represents crashing, burning, destroying, devastating. Deva, a deva is a god, deva, kingdom, deva, state, god, state. So the mad magic mystic master represents the dissolution, the dissolving, the destruction of all we hold dear, all we cling to. Our perfect little gated communities, our perfectly tanned and toned bodies, our perfectly smelling bodies, you know. In the West, especially in America, we're terrified of body odors. So how could we, for example, or being dirty, you know, 99 and 44, 100% pure. Ivory soap. And of course, God has some fun with it when the woman who advertises the soap, she's holding the pure little baby and advertising the soap, turns out later to become a porn star, you know, a very famous porn star. So the 99 and 44, 100% pure mother is, of course, the porn star. Perfect, beautiful, funny, playful. God's joke on us, conundrum. Mucks with our minds, which is exactly what the mad magic mystic masters do. They take the reality and they make it so crazy that you can't make sense out of what they're doing. It's the shattering of the held together walls of Jericho around your soul and your heart and your mind. That wall needs to come down, but we've built huge walls. We're walled in. We're walled in. We're walled in. A famous poem by Robert Frost, "Good Fences Make Good Neighbors," is the one line from it. That's not the title of the poem, if I'm correct. I think it's "Walled In." And in the poem, of course, the poem doesn't say that at all. It's saying the opposite. If you go back and read it, "We meet in springtime, my neighbor and I don't remember it verbatim, to walk the wall, mended wall." That's what it's called, mended wall. And it's about mending the wall there in New England, where all the stones, the rounded stones, were cleared from the fields, the hard scrabble fields, and made into these rock walls. And somehow, every springtime, the neighbors would walk the wall so that it was fair and pick up the stones that somehow had magically rolled off or moved themselves. Who moves them? Robert Frost muses. Elves, perhaps, he says. But his neighbor keeps repeating to him, "Good fences make good neighbors." And Robert Frost in the poem wonders in his mind, what is it we're walling in and walling out? So we've built these great walls around us, and a mad magic mystic master, his mischievousness, his enjoyment, because his walls are gone. From our perspective, he's way too open. And this is the case when a master doesn't care about social convention. You know, God doesn't really care if you walk naked down the street. God won't hold it against you. The local constable and police may, or the woman in her house who hasn't had sex for 25 years, feels all those feelings stirring in her and gets so threatened that she has to call the police. Just nakedness, the beauty of the human body, a beautiful naked human body, stirs up so much. Go to the local gym and find some beautiful bodies. Now, if you can find people with beautiful bodies and beautiful essence, it'll be that much more powerful. And say, come with me, I'm doing an experiment, we're filming. And just go places and have them disrobe and just be naked. And just see what it stirs up. It stirs up playfulness, laughter, attraction, wanting, and horror and revulsion and fear. The whole spectrum. So some mad masters in the Indian tradition would walk around stark ass naked. Stark ass naked. They had no respect left for social convention. They knew that it was all malarkey. It's all just ego-based fear, ego-based control, ego worrying about what the neighbors will think. So these mad magic mystic masters, there was a place for them. And people knew they were touched in the head. Ramakrishna in the last century was insane by any clinical psychologist standards, you know. And then there are masters that come and very appropriately transduce this experience. Transduce means to step it down, like you take the hundreds of thousands of volts of electricity going through the power lines. You can't put that in your light sock, in your socket, in your house. You would blow yourself across the room if you put anything in there. So it needs to be stepped down. In other words, oh, we take that 100,000 volts and bring it down to 110 volts, which is what's in our outlets. So what masters do is they take the 100,000 volts of God, of the sun. Imagine standing on the surface of the sun and being able to remain there. Well, that's what God does. And that's what a master does. So when he brings that energy to step it down, transform it, change its form into something palatable, something we can ingest, absorb, feel, receive from them, those are teacher masters. But not every master is a teacher. Some masters, awakened ones, touched by God, they're just there, living their private enjoyment, right? They enjoy it. They look at the plants and feel the plants. Artists touch on it, you know? When the Impressionists opened themselves, their doors of perception through hash and pot and whatever. I mean, those painters, if you read it and research it, they did all that. That's what opened their doors of perception, so they start seeing the creation, pointillism. They start seeing it turn into little points of light. So that's a little tiny touch of that mad magic, mystic madness. The mad magic, mystic madness masters. The mystic madness masters. Good. Right? So in the West, we need it more palatable. So you have a master that's willing to dress up in a suit, who's willing to put look presentable, according to our mind programs, you know. We were even scared of long hair. I mean, we're so stuck in uniformity that we wear uniforms. Uniform, uni means one, form is the form. We're all the same form. We are wearing uniforms. Here we are walking in line in syncopation. Up, two, three, four, one, two. We're all one and the same. I love Einstein's quote where he says, God did not give man a backbone just so he could walk in uniforms. Uniformly. I'm paraphrasing some. But the essence of it is God did not give us a backbone just so we could march in soldiering. And I'm not putting down that. There's a right time for protecting freedom. There's a right time. Everything has its place. But it's an emergency timeout situation. We've been living under a state of emergency, martial law. Martial law, meaning war, martial, means fighting, war. We've been living under martial law on this planet for 4 million years. The kingdom of peace that Jesus spoke about, it's not here. He said it, my kingdom is not of this world yet. My kingdom is not of this world yet. This is the come here and work it out. This is the therapy group. This is the consciousness raising plane right now. But the original intention is for the earth and the animals and the plants all to function without having to have police forces, warriors, camps, barbed wire, bombs, all that, guns, you know? God did not say, let there be guns. That's something that got created after the place got messed up. It's good to remember that it's not meant to be this way. it is meant to be the way it is when you're in the process of waking up. It's like in a bad relationship. You need to have the bad stuff happen so that you can wake up. So in that sense, it's exactly the way it should be. The earth is exactly the way it should be. It is perfect. It cannot get any more perfect, the earth. Your life situation, exactly where you are, is absolutely perfection. And when you're in the surrender state, you feel that and you go, yes, I love all my problems and everything. It's all perfect. And when you're not, you fight and rail and rage against it. How could in the sense of injustice, blah, 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 missions, Christians, crusaders, Muslim crusaders, you know, crusading against whatever, child pornography, whatever it is, I'm picking the worst thing probably that we can collectively think of. So we go on crusades to shift things, to change the world. And there is a right place and time for that too. The mad magic mystic masters don't participate in that. They've cracked open. God may use them. You know, the Hopis have it. I think the Hayayoka, they may say it that way. The crazy one, the crazy master, the buffoon, the jester, that when they do their ceremonies up on the mesas, the buffoon makes fun. The Hayayoka makes fun of everybody, makes light of everybody. You know, the court jester. The court jester in medieval times saved many a life. As things got tense and hands on the swords, the jester would step in and act it out. And if you got people laughing, they wouldn't kill each other. The mad magic mystic masters are in that tradition. It's the touch of the absurd. It's ridiculous. It's crazy. Is it worth fighting about this? It's what happens to you. Have you ever been in a fight with someone you love? Usually it's with a love relationship. Happens with your kids too sometimes. It's very serious. You're entrenched in your positions. You've taken your battle stances. You've dug your trenches. You're firing at each other. You did this. No, you did this. You don't ever listen to me. You never da-da-da-da. You always da-da-da-da-da. And you're battling and sending stuff back and forth. And somehow in the middle of that magic, sometimes it just dissolves. It happens more with kids. You know, kids will actually be punching and fighting each other, and sometimes it'll just turn into hilarious laughter. They just can't fight. They don't have any strength left. They just start laughing. The kids just start laughing. They can't punch. They can't be angry. The absurdity in me even playing with the energy like this will make some people uncomfortable and have to label me crazy. So it's a tricky business. You know, the mind is very intent on keeping us under control. The mind programming, the socialization, the way we've grown up, what we think is right and wrong and true and blah, blah, blah. So the mind has us caged. So if it senses anything that's going to undo its power over someone, it then has to reject it, whether it's certain sexuality or crazy laughter. You know, anything that's going to break the boxes that we're stuck in, the mind will say, oh, that's dangerous. Don't stay away. If they're crazy, stay away from them, you know. That way it makes sure you never go to the dance. That way it makes sure you never twirl around and fall laughing on the floor, melted in a puddle of goofy godness. You know? The Mad Magic Mystic Masters have melted in the mad puddle of mystic madness and goodness and goofiness. Become ye as little children. And they walk around with it. And that makes people uncomfortable. So, but the category box, it makes the mind uncomfortable. It makes the law and order crowd uncomfortable. It makes orderliness, making the trains run on time. You know, Mussolini gets elected in Italy as a fascist dictator, like Hitler. They were buddies. And for making the trains run on time, it was such a big accomplishment that people were willing to give their power to him. We want order so much. Orderliness somehow will make it all good. If I clean the house enough, spotlessly with super duper Clorox and a million other products that my hero is showing me on the television, somehow, if I keep a clean house, I'll go to heaven. I mean, it's manically crazy. It's obsessive compulsive disorders. Somehow, if I keep the house clean enough, God will come to visit the house? No, God's out in the dirt playing with the kids. God's out in the throwing the dirt around, building tunnels with the kids, finding worms, growing plants, beautiful plants out of the dirt. I'm looking at these beautiful red geraniums right outside. They grow in the dirt. They grow in worm poop. All dirt is worm shit. A worm is a tube that has an opening at one end and one at the other. The earth or the leaves or the roots or whatever it's eating comes in one end, travels through its body, gets digested, mulched around, and poops out the other end. All of the dirt is worm poop. All of it. All dirt on the whole planet has been converted by the holy earthworm, that which we trample on and take the least respect for and take for granted continually and think are icky and use to dig up to stick on fish hooks. We pierce their bodies and fish with them. Kids love them. Kids have a natural awe, respect, excitement, enthusiasm, exploration for the holy earthworm. Not the lowly earthworm, but the holy earthworm. Without the holy earthworm, you would not have any food to eat. Without the holy earthworm, there would be no beautiful flowers. No wonderful swaying in the breeze trees. No amazing saguaro cactus. No banyan tree that Buddha sat under and woke up. That Siddhartha sat under and woke up. God, the Mad Magic Mystic Masters play in the dirt. I'm going to use some shocking examples for you now. There's a master, and these are in India, that's my a lot of my history and tradition, but they're all over. South America, the mad masters, the mad medicine man, that's neither man nor woman, that lives and is honored by the tribe as being in connection with the other world. There's a master that assisted a master that came to America and taught, made a big impression, One of the masters that helped him wake up would walk around stark ass naked. And I'm going to shock you now. And in one of his meetings with him, the student who became the teacher in America with lots of money and big, beautiful retreats and all that, this mad master, he saw him in the corner smearing himself with his own shit. Okay? And who knows why? Now the world would say, okay, this man is completely gone, needs help. You know, thing was, this man would smell beautifully, like perfume all the time. His skin was ageless, beautiful perfume. But to the world, his safety or whatever, he appeared crazy. Another example, and I know that's the ultimate, I'm taking it sort of the ultimate mad magic mystic master stuff. Another one is in northern India, and some people think it's Babaji, who's the eternal deathless master of Yogananda's lineage, that has lived for 9,000 years in the same body, looks about 22 years old, beautiful, half woman, half man, gorgeous, angelic. What would you expect from an eternal immortal master? In one of his forms, who knows what they all do? How can we know what God himself does? God himself is every ray of the sun. Picture the sun for a moment. How much energy, how many sun rays are coming off the sun? Picture a basketball, that's the sun, and a little pea about 3 yards away, 10 feet away. How much of the basketball's energy that's pouring off of it in every direction is actually touching that little pea? How much sunlight do we get from the sun? And only half of that sunlight hits the little pea that is the earth. So how much energy does the sun have? And how much goes to, quote, waste? It doesn't go to waste, but it certainly doesn't ever hit or touch the earth. The sun is this huge, effervescing ball of godness, of which there are trillions. So how can we know when someone has merged with the sun, merged with God? How can we know what they're all up to? So a Babaji is operating in multiple dimensions and multiple bodies all over the place. A little piece of his, I'm surmising, I don't know, but I could imagine a little piece of his consciousness is functioning on Earth. The rest is traveling the cosmos and other planets and so forth. So one of those little pieces of willingness of letting God use him as a body, he manifested a body outside a village in northern India. And he would live on the trash heap. And they found him eating dead dog. Now, and yet miracles would occur. The children would come and flowers would spring forth in their hands. The kids in their innocence could accept the gifts of candy and flowers and pencils and erasers or whatever they needed. They would manifest for them and healings would occur. But in that form he took, he would throw things at people. When he would throw things at people or abuse them or scream at them, they would get healed. That's the mad magic mystic master tradition. Just breaking all the rules. Just following whatever, like a crazy child, mad child, problem child. Rare is the soul that comes in as a real problem child. If you are lucky enough to have a real problem child be born to you, try to not pollute or destroy them and allow them to flower, to flower. A flower is a flow, F-L-O-W. Flower is a flower. A flower is an eruption of flowingness of God. Let your child be a magic flower. A magic flower. Don't be a jackboot stepping on the flowers, crushing them, which is what we do with our kids. It's what we do with our kids. For the most part.